When your mind goes to sleep for 50 years on anything, it takes a while to really scratch the surface and try to recall events. It just blows my mind, though, that year, that game, for me, I mean, it must have made a huge impression on me, because I can remember so many of the details. Not all of them, obviously, but I can remember so many of the details. By the time we arrived at Williams, Len was at the tail end of his coaching career.
Len was somebody that you didn't want to disappoint. I think everybody wanted to make him feel like we had done a good job.
Certainly he was involved. He went from group to group and was involved. But Coach Navarro did the coaching.
Pete DeLisser was the offensive backfield coach.
Len, more than technical football, he had a value system. And he was very rigid about that. And that's what you learned from him. You know, you got to work hard, be on time, don't talk back. He taught that to the kids. If they could think back, they would think that, hey, this guy taught me some good stuff that way.
Come on over, baby, whole lot of shaking going on. Yeah, come on over, baby, baby, you can't go wrong. Honey, I ain't begging, I got a whole lot of shaking going on.
We started out with 40 or 50 on the team, and as early football wore on, some people would get injured and others would just get tired. So we got down to a very small group, a little over 30 or so.
We were in incredibly good shape, I think, because of the rigor of the practice sessions.
We weren't big. We were a very focused and tough group, and they tried hard, very hard. They gave you everything they had, and that made up for their size. And Amherst was big.
From the very beginning, the two have had the rivalry that comes with the origins of Amherst College, that somehow this place wasn't good enough for them, so they went someplace else and established their own college there.
So it has a long history to it. Schools were about the same size, both about the same quality as far as education, and hard to get into and attracted the same kind of people.
This is our last game. This is the make or break game. You can have a 1-7 season, and if the one victory is Amherst, you know, that makes it a good season.
The game was big. It was very important to us. So we thought about it all year long.
We get to the Amherst game, and you know, we're 5-2. Nobody gives us a chance against Amherst.
Amherst came in number one in the Lambert Trophy, and that was an honorable thing in those days.
That was a team that, back in the day of the running game, was averaging 190 yards a game in the air. That's a pretty good number right now, but back then when nobody was throwing the ball, that was off the charts.
They dominated every team they played, and it was expected they would do the same with us.
In football, there's speed, power, and deception, and they had two of the three.
Amherst had never been behind a single time all season.
Somehow being in white made them look bigger and more threatening and more sort of ominous and powerful.
They had a really spectacular season, and they had some really gifted players, so you knew it was going to be a formidable game.
But we thought, you know, when you go out there, you know, we, as Coach Waters used to say, we put our pants on, boys, one leg at a time, just like them.
We knew that we were not a powerhouse that year, and I think relying on Mike was part of the plan.
Coach Waters because the Amherst weekend was a house party weekend, he had us all sleep in the field house thinking we'd get more rest.
I don't remember losing any sleep in preparation for it. Maybe I was foolish not to.
And I don't think I probably had much thinking about it before that game. I just got myself completely emotionally involved before the game, during the game, and even after the game.
We had a lot of confidence in the defensive system that Frank Navarro had designed and installed at Williams.
The names were very catchy. There was a monster, and there was an anchor, and there was a scrape, and there was a nose, and there was a loop tackle, and a boom end.
I never thought I'd see Weston Field totally jammed. We had been told that if we win the toss, boys, we're going to defend. You know, Len wanted us to immediately be on defense because I think they felt as though if we could slow that extraordinary offense, it might send a message to Amherst that this wasn't going to be the walk in the park they thought it might be.
The slant defense and made them feel disorganized in their blocking patterns because Wagner or Gripkoven or Crowley would be in their face before they crossed the line of scrimmage.
As I look back, Mike Reily really was a significantly better football player than most anybody on our team or on anybody else's team. I mean, I'm reminded that Mike never had a bad day. He never had a day in which he wasn't giving 110%. It raised the bar for all of us. We all wanted to do our best.
Playing in the defensive secondary, you hoped for someone to slow the ball carrier down at the line, because if they broke it, they got up ahead of steam before they got to you, and you were going to take the brunt of the hit. I know playing my senior year, there weren't too many kids who ever broke the line. Reily was that good.
I'm walking, here's the knee, and I'm talking, by you and me, I'm walking.
When Choppy Ryan Frank wanted to play football, there was nobody like him. I mean, he turned it on. And that game, he turned it on. That season, he did.
And Amherst couldn't get past the 40-yard line. They still hadn't completed a pass in the whole first quarter.
Carl Davis was very, very good. Holmes was very good. They were very steady.
And what clearly stood out in that first quarter for me was that, one, Amherst wasn't able to do anything on offense. Two, we did move the ball on offense a couple of plays, and our defense helped. The quick kick was used very effectively that year.
We would set the opposing team back on their heels, usually put them way back near their goal line, and then our defense was good enough to hold them, so we could get down and get some sort of turnover in their end of the field, and then score.
So about midway through the second quarter, Mike Reily recovered a fumble. It was on about the 9-yard line.
The line, they were tireless. They could play offense and defense. I mean, Gripkoven, he would give you everything he had. Holmes and Davis, they could block the tackle. Crowley and Reily, they could run the middle plays. We wouldn't have gaping holes, but we would control the line of scrimmage.
And you come back to me. Itching like a man on a fuzzy tree. My friends say I'm acting wild as a bug. I'm in love, I'm all shook up. Ooh, ooh, yeah, yeah.
as you might imagine, the locker room was very upbeat, very upbeat.
Well, at halftime, I don't know whether it's Coach Navarro or Coach Waters said, keep the pressure on. You're going to remember this game the rest of your life. Ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, please don't ask me what's on my mind. I'm a little bit stuck, but I feel fine. When I'm in a good, at all my best, my heart beats so it scares me to death when she touches my hand. I want the chill I got, her lips alive, a volcano that's hot. I'm proud to say that she's my buttercup, I'm in love. Chris finally took it in from the 4-yard line. Ran over Price Gripkoven and I believe it was Carl Davis on the right end, right side of the line. That made the score 12-0. Like a leaf on a tree. That's only one kill for this body of mine. That's to have that girl and her love so fine. She touched my head and what the chill I got. Her lips are like a volcano that's hot. I'm proud to say that she's my buttercup. I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Ooh, ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh, ooh, yeah, yeah. I'm all shook up. As sophomores, the thing that was important to us was the seniors. It was what Bruce Grinnell, what John Newton, Dan Crowley. I mean, Dan Crowley, I played next to Dan all season. Dan doesn't say much, but he plays hard. And Price Gripkoven on the other side, same thing. Those guys, none of them. Choppy was the only one who was slightly crazy.
I didn't realize how much of a team effort we had that day. Everybody covered everybody's back. If Crowley slanted out or looped out, Ben Wagner came in behind him, and if there was a trap play, he met it head on, made a tackle in the backfield. If Carl Davis had to play the sweep first and drop in the flat to be in the flat for coverage, he did it. If Choppy had to shuffle and figure out what was going on, then rush the passer, he did it. I mean, we had a team, there was a team effort there.
When you have a defense with Ben Wagner, Choppy Ryan Frank, and Al Hageman, and Mike Reily, and the rest of the gang, saddling up, some of them for the last time, on their home field, being challenged as to how good are you? 54 minutes it took Amherst to get into Williams territory.
Line played an extraordinary game. Extraordinary game. I mean, Wagner and Gripkoven and the ends. I mean, good Lord, you know, they tried sweeping those ends and get nowhere. I mean,
great players play well in big moments. Mike was a tremendous force in that game. He had 9 tackles, 2 interceptions. He recovered a fumble that set up the first TD. He was all over the field.
Thank you.
After the game, it was essentially a blur. I was with my family.
I was looking forward to a nice, shall we say, party time after the game, win or lose. When we won, it was even better.
And Saturday night was a fabulous party night.
Pete Marlowe took his jacket off and laid it at my feet because I was such an important person. It's taken me a while, but I figured out that was probably not true, but...
Anytime a team plays like that, that means they like each other. They like what they're doing. They have a reason for playing. And that showed up on that November day.
I'm walking, hear the need, and I'm talking. But you and me, I'm hoping that you come back to me. What you gonna do when the well run dry? You gonna run away and hide. I'm gonna run right by your side. For you, pretty baby, I even die. I'm walking. Yes, indeed.